YT Productions.
Yeah.
I love my HBCU.
And boy,
I love it, love it. Yeah. I love it, love it. Yeah. I love my HBCU.
And man,
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
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 I tune into the HBCU Sports Lab to see if my team won or lost. If they lost, I'm quiet as a mouse. But if they won, keep tab. I'ma do the dab, yeah. Dr. Cavil, he know what he be talking about. Mike and Charles, they know what they be talking about. They compress the analytic data with your hip hop.
If you know them like I know them,
they gon' tell you if your team, if they wanna lose. And who the ball, who the ball.
So listen to Professor, yes sir,
yes sir.
And pay attention, cause he gon' teach a lesson.
And you gon' learn today, you gon' learn today, how your team they play,
they play,
how they play, boy, you gon' learn today, how your team
they play,
how they play, yeah. We represent the SWAC, that MEAC, and let me say, what's up the team?
This is Dr. Gavin with Inside the HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington, Charles Bishop. Welcome to episode 130 again on the Inside HBCU Sports Lab radio show and podcast. The show that's covering the HBCU diaspora. All things HBCU sports institutions, large and small, NAIA to the NCAA. We share insights and information on the HBCU sports culture and HBCU athletic aesthetics to facilitate the story of HBCU athletic programs and the business of HBCU sports. I'm your host, Dr. Kenyatta Cavil, along with my co-host, Mike Washington and Charles Bishop. We're filming from our home studios and sending a signal live to KSWH 30 AM studios with Texas Radio Hall of Famer Ralph Cooper in the beautiful home of Texas Southern University. We'll jump right into it. We have Stephen Gaither of HBCU Gameday. As I said, he's going to break it. As he broke it today, we're going to let him talk about it right now on the show. What went down today, Stephen?
First of all, thanks for having me on. Sorry about my surroundings here. I'm on my way to get a facial. You know, if I would have known I was getting FaceTime with y'all, I would have got it done earlier. But
big
news. Obviously coming out of SWAC, just a couple days ago, Southern won their third straight Bayou Classic, throttling Grambling State. And, those 19th in the country, feeling pretty good about themselves going into the fall. But there's going to be some changes on the bluff. He's the longest coach, Dawson Odums, the longest running coach in the SWAC at this point. He has decided he's taking his talents to the 757. So he's got the news today that he's resigned as head coach over at Southern University to take the position over there at Norfolk State University, vacated by Latrell Scott a couple of weeks ago as he took the job at East Carolina. So it's pretty interesting as we get into this unprecedented year, 13, 14, 15 months, where, usually you bring in a new coach, in December or January. And now you're talking about bringing them in almost May.
No doubt about it. Any insights in terms of like the contract length or anything like that? Have you heard any of that information?
There's reports that they're out there that are 6 years in the $225,000 range, which honestly, if that's true, isn't much more than Odums was making down in Baton Rouge. And, I'm not a taxologist or anything. I leave that to people who know, what the difference between that is, the cost of living in Baton Rouge and Norfolk, Virginia. But I think the thing is, just following Coach's career, and he started the same year at Gameday, started in 2012 over there in Southern. So just following his career, he's won a lot, been successful. But Southern is one of those jobs where, they expect to win, especially since Peace Richardson showed up 30 years ago. They just expect you to win championships year after year. And every year, pretty much since he's been there, they've definitely been in the conversation. Of course, there's the stretch that Grambling had, as well as Alcorn State. So I think there's high expectations, but a lot of times those expectations resource-wise aren't necessarily met. He's had a lot of folks from his coaching tree Barry over there at Benedict, of course, is a former teammate in North Carolina Central. Trey Oliver got the job at North Carolina Central a couple of years back. So, you know, there's a lot of things, I think, on the outside looking in. We look at wins and losses, and by all measures, he was successful there. We look at, you know, recruiting and things like that, which are all important. But there's so many other things that go into a program. And, you know, I guess it seems as though the time there for Dawson Odums, it just kind of – sometimes you got to know when to hold him and know when to fold him. And I guess it looked like he was you know, I guess he felt like he could do he tapped out what he could do there in Baton Rouge and looking for a new challenge over there in Norfolk State and the MEAC.
Yeah, great points you make, especially when you talk about last thing we heard is that he got a contract extension that was basically 1 year, but it only rolled to 2021. So 6 years versus one, that seems pretty easy when the money is about the same and you get another opportunity. So if that's the case, that's interesting. When you get some more news or any breaking news, you're always welcome to break it right here after you write your report. So just want to say thanks for giving us some time. We'll bring you back on because we want to see if we can get you in here to do some co-hosting with us to break down some other HBCU news and notes that you have across HBCU Gameday.
Gotcha. No worries. That's why I'm going to get the facial now, get a little FaceTime like TC.
That's right.
I appreciate and I appreciate you guys for having him on and me on and just letting us and working together. It's great. So appreciate it.
No problem at all.
No problem.
You Gameday. As we are adapting to the system, we wanted to break the news right here. So let's go over right directly into our interview. None other than, y'all know him as Ruben Studdard, the Velvet Teddy Bear. I know him as Chris. We call each other cousins. Actually, cousin to my wife, Faith Washington. A great guy. Just wanted to say welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah.
There you go. All right.
Oh, none other than. So let me just start out this. Many people, if they don't know, I'm surprised. I gave you a little love today. Alabama A&M Bulldog.
Thank Folks you, sir.
Recruited out of Birmingham. Huffman High School, I believe it is, to go play football at Alabama A&M.
That's correct.
I know you always had the music bug, but you decided to get into music. You majored in music. Mm-hmm. And look at where you are now.
Yes, Alabama A&M, definitely. To be fair to myself, at the time, I had no intention of going to Alabama A&M. And this is because everybody in my family goes to this school. Like, I did not want to go there. The man I'm named after, my Uncle Ruben, was the first one in our family to go to Alabama A&M. Subsequently, my Aunt Pauline went. My mom went, several of my older cousins, and I just had no desire to go there. And, you know, I took every absolute I could take, and Alabama A&M was the last one. Like, I mean, I took all my official trips, and Coach Towns was like, come on up here, son. I still want you to come see A&M.
Okay.
And, you know, so – a little backstory. I think my mom and all of her classmates back in the day had a crush on Coach Town. So when he came to the house to recruit me, she was like, "Well, anywhere you want him to go, he can go. That will take him with you." So I went up there, man. And Alabama A&M at the time was playing Tuskegee in a basketball game, and it was that sold me on coming to A&M, like the. I grew up around so many HBCUs, but I had never experienced the kind of intense love for the universities that people have in those basketball arenas. Because back in the day, they used to be super tight. It wasn't like, you know, it is now where you can kind of spread out. People are playing at bigger venues. But when I first went to A&M, we was all on top of each other. So, I appreciate my experience. I would not be the singer that I am right now had it not been for Dr. Richard Tucker and Dr. Carney. Like, they gave me so much real world advice, and so many people at Alabama A&M were so inspirational to me in general. So I'm thankful that I made that decision.
No doubt about it, man. You got people shouting out American Idol two-season winner in the house. Shout out to the MMW, SIAC days when Ruben was there. Man, you got some folks that know a little bit about the Browns. Skip Townsend is legendary at Alabama. He was a heck of a defensive mind. Coach for another one. So, yeah, you got your folks out here giving me. So, let's get in here what you want to talk about so I can get Charles and Mike in here to ask you a couple questions. But you want to talk Magic City class. I get this random phone call because I ain't heard from him in years. You know, he's so busy, big time, man. I don't get to talk to him. He don't even have a text. I certainly don't get no phone call. But I'm like, who did what? You see the scope? I say, Alabama A&M must be winning. He say, you ain't watch the game. I say, man, you the HBCU game, they you supposed to watch it out. I say, cuz, I got it on, man. I'm watching it. I'm just
Look, man, you know, it's always a pleasurable experience when I can turn the TV on and see Alabama State get routed in the way that they got routed this last weekend. It was just, and you know, I have we also have a cousin of ours, Dr. Darryl Murray, who is my first cousin, and he's Faith's first cousin, but He played football at Alabama State and baseball at Alabama State. My Uncle Tom Lee, they both played. My Uncle Tom Lee played in the 50s at Alabama State. And it just always makes me feel great when the Bulldogs trample on the Mosquitoes of Alabama State University. Excuse me, I meant the Yellow Jackets. Excuse me, I meant the Alabama State Hornets.
Oh, let the smack talk begin. That's good stuff. Charles, let me let you jump in here and ask all of them.
I think the million-dollar question is, Ruben, Alabama A&M, they're going to be playing for the SWAC Championship. Are you going to make the trip, or are you going to check out the Bulldogs in person?
Man, listen, I'm probably going to watch the game on television, to be fair. I probably won't be going to any in-person any in-person games until the fall. So that just is what that is. I haven't even been on the road at all. So I don't start back touring until like July, August. So I'm definitely not just going to go to a random football game just to be going. But when the fall comes back around, I feel like more people will be vaccinated. You know what I'm saying? It'll be time to get back in them stadiums and do what we do. Cuz knows that I get down for the classic. My tailgate is the best, period, hands down, without question.
Whatever. Mike, it's time you to get in here. Get on it, man. Teach him what it means to
tell. Is Mike Washington, is he an Alabama State guy?
No.
No.
Look, you better take a look at that sign behind me.
You know I got to have that Alpha Phi Alpha fraternity stuff on there, man. You know what's up. Okay.
My daddy's frat brothers. Always.
That's right. Your daddy know best. That's right. So I heard you say, you know, you're not going to the game. You talked about, you know, your experiences. So, you know, tell me, what is an essential tailgating experience at Alabama A&M, and what does that look like? And part two is, what a 205 shirt you had?
What 205 shirts do I have now? None. I don't have any.
Yeah.
The ones that I had, my mom had, and then I gave two of them to like the Alabama Music Hall of Fame.
Oh, nice.
So I don't have any of them, like any of those original ones. I'm sure there's some fakes rolling around here somewhere, but I don't have any. As far as tailgating is concerned, you know, the one thing I will say about my HBCU experience is that I made friendships that have lasted my whole life. And so me and my guys, we get the same spot every year at Legion Field because the lady that works in the office is also a Bulldog. So when I go in there, I go and I get my stuff and I pay for, because you know the spots are kind of small, so I buy like five or six spots so we can all be around. And then we have our TVs out there, you know, we pull the grill out there. And the thing that's been happening lately, though, because in the beginning, because, you know, people don't understand that Mad City Classic tailgating is a relatively new phenomenon. Mm. Like, when I was a kid, in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s, people weren't really tailgating at the Classic. It was really just about going and being fresh, you know what I'm saying? Going out there with your finest clothes on and stunning those folks. Now, it's like a whole day, whole weekend kind of thing. So, we get out there Friday, bro, or really Thursday, because you have to have your spot paid for by the Tuesday.
Tell us about some of your famous tailgate dishes. That's what people want to know.
Man,
What is an Alabama A&M tailgate dish that you could hang your hat on?
So it's about the fried fish, bruh. It's about the fried fish, bruh.
I'm listening.
It does not matter. Like, and when I tell you, we have a spread, bro. We have ribs, we have chicken, we got beans, we have everything you can think of. We also, the day of the game, we also cook breakfast. We do a whole thing out there, okay? But we start frying fish when I come out of the stadium at halftime. After halftime, we walk out the stadium and then we crank the grease up. We might be out there at like 8 or 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night, still going with that grease, bro. That's the thing. Like, I think that's like the big piece of the – if you don't got that good fried fish, man, like, it ain't really no tailgate.
That man, is so not what I expected you to say.
What you thought I was going to say? Some hot dog, a hamburger, something?
I've been all over. I've been to tailgates. I did not expect you to throw the fry. I expect fried fish to be Georgia, Mississippi, not Alabama.
Really?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Man, all I was going to say, that's some Eastern Division stuff. In the West Division, we got a little more flavor in the West Division. We'll put on a brisket.
Put on Texas brisket. And we don't get started on Thursday. We get started on Wednesday and Tuesday. Just to let you know.
Hey, man, can't nobody take all them days off work to be taking our week. Thursday, you know what I'm saying? Thursday is enough, bro. y'all out there cooking whole sides of beef. Anybody got time to do all that, man?
So tell me, what is your favorite memory of a Magic City Classic? And what's your favorite memory of a home football game or basketball game?
I would say my favorite memory, because I have so many, brother. Yeah. Like, I really do. But the most memorable for me was like right after I won American Idol, and they asked me to be the Grand Marshal of the parade and the Massive Classic. Like, it almost brought me to tears. Like, I was so excited. I was still managed by the people that ran American Idol, and they were like, so this Magic City Classic, it really must be that important to you, because we have XYZ, XYZ, like, they just ran the amount of money that I was losing for not working that weekend.
Wow.
I didn't care. I was just like, yeah, man, I'm going to be in the parade. I'm great. Hey, I'm on that 95.7 float. I'm coming in the stadium. I'm singing that national anthem. I'm doing everything I wanted them to ask me to do before I was famous. They should have been asking me to sing the national anthem at the game when I was 17 years old.
Well, I want to say thank you for singing the national anthem at the basketball game I put together with Alabama A&M and way back then. And this is before anybody else knew you as the Velvet Teddy Bear. This is when like you said, starving student at the time, came into the house. You took care of me, but I always,
hey, man. You've been family since day one, boy.
He opened up the oven. I said, man, what you doing? He said, we're gonna heat this thing up, man. So that's real truth, man. That's
pretty cool. Hey, but we kicked it though, didn't we?
Absolutely. He is smooth. Let me tell you something. He is smooth in many different facets. Smooth, brother. Down to earth. But heart is golden. when you talk about that and just real person, real with anybody that comes with him and talk to him, sincere. The money, the music has not changed him. It's a love for him, what it is. So I just wanted the people to get a chance to see the side of him. Because a lot of times people don't get the side of this because, you know, when you do other places, you know, they want those traditional type of comments and stuff like that, which is good, but you get to come with us and his family, so we get to talk about it. So let's get in there. Last couple of questions, then I'll give you the mic and say whatever you want to say. But, you know, the SWAC is expanding now. SWAC goes to 12 teams with FAMU and Bethune-Cookman. You got FAMU, Bethune-Cookman, Alabama State, Alabama A&M, Jackson, and Mississippi Valley State, Jackson State, that is, in the Eastern Division. What are your thoughts in terms of, one, the SWAC expanding, and what is to become of the Eastern Division?
I think that it's very exciting for the SWAC to be expanding. I also think that bringing a school like Florida A&M and Bethune, schools like Florida A&M and Bethune-Cookman into the SWAC, it just lets everybody know how serious our conference is. Like, people always, you know, like, there are certain schools in the SWAC that people are always like, are like premier, like, especially in when it comes to athletics. And that is, has for certain always been Grambling. Like, people look at Grambling as like the gold standard of SWAC athletics, just because they've had so many people that have done so well at a, you know, at a higher level. But I think that now having Florida A&M come in, and the thing that the people sometimes try to downplay, especially us in the athletic world, like, we downplay the importance of our bands in these games. And what you all understand is that Southern's band and Florida A&M's band are two of the probably most profitable bands in the country. And that energy in the SWAC, I might be, you can keep looking at your earphones, sir. You keep looking at the earphones. You keep looking at them. I don't care. I'm just going to
say, you just got to say something about Jackson State.
But I mean, it's something to say, hey, man, it's something to be said about that Sonic Boom. It's something to be said about it. I'm not going to disrespect the Sonic Boom. All I'm saying is, brother, when you think about, and look, I think the March of Maroon and White is one of the best bands in the world, but they are not FAMU. Jackson State is not FAMU. Southern is not. When I'm talking about.
Wow.
Hey, man.
Tell them, hey, this is your interview.
Am I saying something that everybody hadn't heard before?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
My brother from Jackson State is living in his own blue and white delusion. That's fine. What I'm saying is, I think it's going to be great, man. I think I look forward to possibly going to a homecoming at Alabama A&M and Florida A&M are playing against each other. Like, how great would that be, going to a game where Jackson State and Florida A&M are playing against each other? You get to see those two great football teams, those two great bands on the field at halftime. That's going to be huge, man. Like, the coverage on these games. And I think that, you know, what I have noticed recently is how many of these young athletes are taking HBCU programs serious. Yeah. And that, to me, that gives me so much pride, because it's like, you know, and to be fair, I'm an Alabama fan. I like University of Alabama. But would I prefer that every top five recruit in Alabama went to Alabama A&M, Alabama State? Absolutely. Because they don't need it. They don't need it. Like, we need the publicity. We need people coming to our games. We need to have 20, 30,000 plus fans in our stands every weekend so that we can sustain our program. So kudos to those young men for making the choice to go to HBCUs this year, especially those ones with, like, super high recruits. That filled my heart with joy when I saw that on ESPN this week.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Excuse me, Doc. Dr. Cavil.
Laugh a little, Charles, Bishop Charles on note. I thought Big Rude, new music, Sonic Boom with the South. They fixed the sound issue, Charles. G Boom said that's going to turn you on you for you saying that. Kim Washman said, I'm waiting on you to mention the March of Storm. Kim and Frazier said, hey.
I love everybody. I just have to keep it 100, man. You know, like, I love everybody, man. But at the end of the day, I'm a represent the album and them first, and then everybody else is, you know.
There you go.
No doubt.
Supposed to do that. Any other final question you want, Charles and Mike?
Well, for somebody who's kind of grown up in that Magic City culture, I mean, and one of the things I wanted to ask is, like, what is something that I would definitely have to do with Magic City Classic?
Okay, so if you're not from Birmingham, I would encourage anybody that is not from Birmingham to, one, go to the parade on Saturday morning. I know it might be a bit of an inconvenience because the game is like right there, but it's good to kind of see how Birmingham comes out and supports these two universities early in the morning. I'm sorry, guys. Can y'all hear me?
Okay.
It's good to see how Birmingham comes out and supports these teams. Our every year, either the mayor or the city council throws like super huge galas to support the scholarship programs at each school. And for the adults that are listening, like, that's a good way for you to get involved civically. Also have a good time because they generally always have a well-named act, a performance. I mean, the tickets are kind of, you know, around $150, $200, but it's worth it to support the scholarship programs. And also, you know, just I think that people who've never been to the Magic City Classic would do well to come out there while the game is going on and just walk around the stadium and get an opportunity to see all of those black-owned businesses that are out there, like with their, you know, T-shirts and HBCU paraphernalia, fraternity and sorority paraphernalia. Like, all, it's like so much stuff that you can get in and around that stadium during that time. And it's just a really good time, and to see how BET comes out. ESPN is there. Like, it has turned into like a really, really, I mean, they have like the BET sound stage out there every year now where they have artists, you know, so it has turned into a thing that's more, it's more than about the game. It's about the experience.
No doubt about it, Mike.
Yeah. So, you may have answered the question, but let's say I'm a high school student and you said yourself, you didn't want to go to Alabama A&M.
Right.
But you ended up going there, being a Bulldog, ride or die. Sell me on going there now. What sold you? What would you tell somebody that's in high school and contemplating an HBCU? What would you tell them about Alabama A&M that would maybe sway them to go up there to Birmingham?
I think that my answer won't be any different than anybody else that graduated or matriculated at HBCU. It's important when you're in school to not just feel like a number, but to feel like you're cared for and thought about. And for me, in every instance, in every department, everywhere I went, there was somebody there that took a special interest in Ruben Studdard. Awesome. And those things matter, like, you know, because, you know, in 4 years, you will hopefully be, you know, leading a great career, doing the thing that you love. But there aren't going to be people like that everywhere you go that build you up so that you can stand on mountains and break down barriers in certain industries and stuff. You know, it's people I went to school with that have created laser technology and have like become like, you know, like, especially with me in the music department, I got friends of mine that have like done things that we haven't seen very many African-American people do. And it's, you know, I think it's because we get so much confidence in that place while we're there that we can go out and do anything. And, yeah, you know, one of our mantras is start here, go anywhere. So I'm telling you, if you go to HBCU, you or any historically black college university, you'll be doing yourself a great service because the love that you'll receive will help you in your future endeavors.
Well said. Appreciate it.
Well said.
Do y'all called the Hill too?
Absolutely.
But so, because we're called a hill, but we're the real hill at Prairie View A&M. The Prairie View.
Listen, you know, sir, I've been to Texas a lot of times, and I've seen some mole hills. But Dr. Cavil can attest to that we are actually sitting on the side of actual mountainous hills,
yeah.
Sir.
They on the mountain.
I've been up there,
especially when I had the ice there, and my truck started to slide down there and scared me to death. Yeah, I was like, yeah, this is real. I wasn't used to driving another.
But you know, as we say when we come on the field before halftime, often imitated, never duplicated. So you could call yourself the hill, bro, but we all know what a real hill is.
Hey, you got the executives coming out. John Grant, executive director of the Celebration Bowl and the MEAC SWAC Challenge, says, do you have any information on what will happen to the tailgating when the game moves next year to the new stadium? Any thoughts on that?
That has been me and my friends, we talked about this, and none of us are super excited about it. So what I think that they proposed is that the tailgate still be at Legion Field and then play the game at the new stadium, which is going to be, you know, weird, but it may work out. You know what I mean? Because Birmingham has figured out, have you ever rode the shuttle from the Civic Center to the stadium?
Yeah, I have.
So we have like a really great, during the classic, a really great shuttle system that runs every 10 minutes. Like it's, you know, a ton of, so maybe that could be like something that they can implement where the shuttle goes from Legion Field to the stadium, like in between tailgate and game. But I don't know, man. I'm on the fence about that because the stadium is beautiful. Like it's a beautiful stadium. I just don't think it's enough room for us to get down, baby. Can't get down.
No doubt about it.
How we gonna do the electric slide and the bunny hop in the protective light? We can't do all that out there.
Oh,
you know,
man.
What I'm saying? I hope that I got my own. I ain't worried about Joseph. Hey, we know we got to get it, man. Ain't nobody
man, it's been great. I want to give you last couple of minutes. Tell anybody how they can get up with you. I know you're doing a new YouTube channel.
Yes.
You can talk about that. Make sure you tell people how to catch up with you. Like you said, when you get back on tour, when can they go find out some more information?
So everybody can follow me at, I'm on Instagram, Real Ruben Studdard. I'm on, what's the Twitter, Ruben Studdard. Facebook, Ruben Studdard, my Facebook fan club, all Ruben Studdard. And then I started a podcast with one of my friends. It's called Vice Styles. It is basically like a show that talks about all things men centric. So we talk about football, basketball, sports, cigars, whiskey, clothes, like all the stuff that we do as fellas. And it's me and my partner, Terrence. He's an Alabama State graduate. I'm from Alabama A&M. We're both in the same music fraternity, Phi Mu Alpha. And then our co-host is William Geddes. His family all went to Mississippi Valley State. He went to Alabama, but he helps keep us together from always, because me and Terrence like to fuss all the time. So he keeps us from doing that so we can stay on top. But it's called Vice Styles. We have our YouTube channel is called at Vice Style. So y'all check that out. And I'll be back on the road after this is all said and done. We canceled so many shows due to COVID. And the most difficult thing now is like trying to, because all those theaters are replacing their dates for the end of 2020 into 2021. So come to my RubenStutter.com website RubenSingsLuther.com website. Oh. And you can see the dates when they come back up in the fall. And that's about it, man. I love you guys. Thank y'all for having me, Doc. I appreciate you rocking that shirt. You know what I'm saying? You got that Masters on the heel, so you know what I'm saying?
That about it. I got a lot of love for Alabama A&M.
You know what I'm saying? I let you get my cousin up there on the heel. And y'all still owe me $5 for letting me take my cousin.
You let a little too much out now.
Right.
Man, it's been a pleasure. It's been a blast. Like I said, when you need me on the show to come in there and talk about some HBCU sports, you got it.
No I problem. Got you.
I like to mediate some of that the banner y'all going back and forth. But much luck, continued success, and just stay grounded. The Velvet Teddy Bear, y'all got it, everybody right here. Alabama A&M's own HBCU, SWAC, SIAC, and all that right here. Connect.
Thank you, guys.
So we'll be right back after the break. But before you leave, we want to bring on Roy Evans, our producer. He wants to come in and say a couple of things to you real quick.
Okay.
Oh, Mr. Studdard, I just want to say on behalf of Rally Nation, we want to thank you for being the logical SWAC person and understanding the value of the Marching 100 coming to the SWAC. We really, really appreciate that, sir. And just so y'all know, we will be cutting that into a clip and running it over and over and over.
Hey, man, I can only speak the truth, man. That's what it is, man.
Truth to power. Hey. This is Dr. Gill with Inside HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington and Charles Bishop. We have our very special guest, Chris Ruben Studdard, the Velvet Teddy Bear, as I should say, as everybody knows, an Alabama A&M representing for the city of Birmingham and the greater Alabama for all that matters. I want to say thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This break, thank stay you. With us. We've got a little more as we close up on the second half of the show. Thank you.
The human voice has always connected audiences with experiences. Major brands all across America have trusted Kever's voice time and time again. Conversational, powerhouse, intelligent, and sincere. That's the voice you need for your creative marketing process. KeversVoice.com. Kever's voice.com. Always on, all the time.
They compress the analytic data with your hip hop. If you know them like I know them, they gon' tell you if your team, if they wanna loud, yeah. And who the ball. So listen to Professor, yes sir, yes sir. And pay attention, cause he gon' teach a lesson.
This is Dr. Bill with Inside HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington, Charles Bishop. Shout out to Kim Washington and Wendy Jenkins Bishop showing us much love on the show. Appreciate you all. Showing all the type of love. I got the guys tied up, so I appreciate you giving a little bit of moment at a time. With that, let's jump back into it. Some of the hot news of the day, let me get your thoughts on it. I'm going to jump in there first, obviously. The cancellation of the Jackson State-Prairie View game, it's official now. Due to COVID-19 issues on Jackson State side, or at least that's the story, we're going to stick with it right now. Due to COVID-19 protocols and contact tracing with Jackson State football program, Saturday's football game versus Prairie View A&M is canceled and will not be made up. Mike told me that was y'all didn't want to see Prairie View come down there. Charles,
you know what, Mike? Go with that narrative. I like that. Go with that. If that's what you want, then go with it. I ain't saying Jackson State will beat Prairie View last couple years, but go with that. Go with that.
And you did ruin our little Thursday night television game, man. And
I
brought you to the suite. I promise y'all, I almost kicked you out of that suite. Your mom.
Yeah, I know.
That is not going to be a good leak. Calling himself my friend, and I put him out. So I'm like, whoo, that was a good move bringing your mom. That was a real good move.
I had to use a little subterfuge on that. So.
Yeah, it's a beautiful woman there, too. She's very gracious about everything when she did. So,
yeah, I do want to give Charles Bishop and the 14 Club their just due on those pre-game interviews and focuses that they do. Those shots are incredible, and the interview, the professionalism, nice job on that, guys. I really do have to tip my hat on that. I still don't think you wanted this L from PB, but I got to give you just due.
No, definitely appreciate that. You know, me and my partner back in Jackson, Neely, with the pregame show, is definitely a labor of love. And we're really looking to do a lot more things, which really expanding very quickly. And it's really growing the Jackson State fan base and the HBCU fan base in general. So to have a platform like this to to jump off another platform, especially with Jackson State Athletics, it means the world. So, yeah, we're really getting into it, and it's more to come.
I literally got breaking news. This is from the Vice President of Intercollegiate Athletics, Kevin Granger. They just had several players test positive for COVID-19. And as of this morning and yesterday, the game was on between Texas Southern and Pine Bluff. And it's my understanding now, because of COVID protocols and multiple players testing positive, that game is now off. That is literally breaking news. So you got it right here. Not the kind of news we want to break, but it's what we do, as we have all our teams today on the show. Which brings me to the surge in COVID-19 cases led Winston-Salem State to cancel spring sports. Football practice
from
sports.com, citing the surge of COVID-19. Winston-Salem Journal reported that athletic director E.T.N. Thomas canceled the rest of spring football practice because of spikes in coronavirus cases. But this is a discussion I want to have now. Yes, the vaccinations are coming out. Many people are getting them. It's up, but I'm of concern with the false narratives, what I would call it, outright lies. What you see in the Southern, because of what I'm seeing as politics, Republican politics, to be specific, don't have to bite the tongue. I'm extremely concerned from a different perspective. It's my understanding with the COVID-19 vaccinations that people will not die if they have that. You can still catch COVID-19. You can still get sick. What level is the question? It's almost 100% in regards to the death. But how is this going to play out? As we talk about the exciting closing out this year with the SWAC Championship game, we're right on the edge of getting that done. And so hopefully, with everybody being safe, we'll be able to play the championship game in 2 weeks. But more importantly, going into the fall, you know, what is this going to look like? I asked this question to Texas Southern coach McKinley regarding that. You know, what is his thought with things not seeming to be changing in terms of people's attitude? How do you think this is going to play out in the fall? And he talked about, you know, one of the things maybe is to get vaccination. Well, there's a conversation going around, it seems like, in the North. My understanding, Rutgers University is requiring students coming back to campus to take shots. You see that in Michigan with some of the universities, Midwest, throughout that area. But you're coming to the South, you got places like Florida, Georgia, not only on top of what they're doing for voting rights, which we've seen play out today in terms of the other issue in terms of policing in this country. How is that going to play out in terms of us trying to have a game? You got the Celebration Bowl. Talking about John Grant, MEAC SWAC Challenges. They're trying to do things in a manner that will uplift HBCUs. But you have that big issue about people starting to talk about boycotts. These are going to be some serious issues that at some point are going to come to a head.
Yeah.
And we had a good time on the show talking about it, but with the breaking news, I think it's our point to really look at this seriously and talk about this. So I'm going to go to you first, Charles, to kind of frame all that. You can pick apart either one of those that you want to go at, and we can have a little dialogue in terms of where we're looking forward in terms of the fall, in terms of COVID-19, the protocols, and how that may affect not just football, but other sports as well.
Well, I mean, getting back to normalcy, to be quite honest, it's going to take a little longer than what I think – the majority of us was anticipating. I thought sort of the vaccinations aspect of it would be the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. But of course, there is concerns with regards to the efficacy of certain vaccines and you know, just a lot of I guess myths to dispel with regards to the vaccine. So it's going to take us, I think, a little bit longer to get back to what we once saw as normalcy. I'm hopeful that people sort of get over, personally, I'm hopeful that people get over the stigma or whatever you might be associated with the vaccinations. I know we all have done our vaccinations. Going back to Jackson State games is part of the testing protocol now that I think will be standard nowadays in terms of having, you know, proximity to the sidelines and press box and things of that nature. It's a whole new world that we're living in, and we're going to have to figure out how and where to navigate. Dr. Cavil, you mentioned the social climate within the South. And that's something that is also very much of a concern, because playing politics with something like a pandemic is just beyond my comprehension. So I just have to say it like that, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it's beyond a lot of folks' comprehension. I think you said it very well. Let me let Mike jump in here and give some of his thoughts. He can add in a business perspective, as he always does, in terms of the data analytics components of it. What are your thoughts, whether it's the cultural side or the business side? What do you think?
Yeah, I think you see kind of a paradigm shift. I think you have to factor in, number one, that, you know, as Charles alluded to, people thought this vaccination was the answer. You know, and as you said yourself, you know, even if you're vaccinated, you're susceptible to still get COVID-19. You have all of these variant streams, the latest being the one from London that has become the dominant variant of COVID-19. You have a larger number of younger people that are being impacted. So you have all of these moving pieces happening. You do have hospitalizations going down, but now you're seeing an uprise in COVID-19 exposures. A large part of that may be that now testing has become part of the mandate as opposed to it being a choice. And now it's the mandate. So you're seeing a lot, you know, statistically, you're seeing a lot more cases. But when you come to the fall, I think you have to take a look back and you have to say, you know, we're not normal. What we think is normalcy is not going to be what we think is normalcy. It's going to be a newer normalcy. There are going to be some protocols that we have to maintain or have to keep in place. I think testing is going to be maintained going into the fall. I think vaccinations are going to be maintained. There are plenty of legal cases in corporate America that say if a company or institution wants to require you to take a vaccination, there's no legal precedent that says they can't do it. So you'll see some colleges and universities requiring students. You'll see some that won't. The other thing is kind of the opinion and the vaccine. You still have a large segment of the population out there that just is not accepting of the vaccination for various reasons. So you have to deal with that as well. So your protocols are going to have to, you know, address those who have taken the vaccine, those who, you know, for whatever reason, choose not to take the vaccine, whether they're unclear how it impacts them biologically, whether they're questions about pregnancy or whatever, whether they're, you know, just confused on how it affects your body long term. Students, organizations, schools are going to have to answer these questions. And it's a newer set of questions that you have to that you didn't have to answer in 2020. In 2020, it was all about protocol, keeping clean. Don't let people get close. Now it's, you know, limited audience. What is our testing facility? Who's going to get vaccinated? Are we going to make it mandatory? So it's a paradigm shift going into the fall. And what that looks like, nobody knows. That's kind of that crystal ball.
My question is, what are the options to not doing the vaccine? That's what kind of baffles me. I understand the hesitancy, but what are the options to not? You know, are you waiting for herd immunity or whatever the case might be and continue to sort of put yourself in peril? Or I just don't understand the argument as to why not.
What you hear in corporate America is a lot of folks are waiting for herd immunity. That name gets tossed out quite a bit. And a lot of folks are saying,
the problem that people say about herd immunity that people need to understand, that doesn't mean if you hadn't got it and you're sick that you won't get it.
Right.
And if you don't have the shot, that means that you have every fatality that anybody else had. Herd immunity means that everybody with it has an ability not to be the worst saints of it. So I think people need to also understand that. I think you have a lot of folks that believe they're waiting till they get information or more of the output and see how people do with it. which I think is one scenario. I think you also have a lot of people that are feeling that they are healthy enough, which is another component of it. And I think that's a different framework of mind, those that are with that have that value that are healthy disposition, and they're thinking if they catch it, that they can survive it. I think that's a different dynamic that people need to understand. Because the question is, yeah. Now, it's not whether if you're going to get it. The question is when are you going to get it?
When are you going to get it?
So that's what
and how would it and when you get it, how would it impact you?
Right. That's what I'm saying. Is it so? And you can't control it. You don't have that dynamic to really know that. You can be as healthy as possible, which means you have a better likelihood of fighting it off. But you don't even know if you have some disease that is not present that you can't really understand that will be acutely affected by the disease. Right. So that's the thing that I hope people are starting to understand, is that it's not if you're going to get it, it's going to win, unless you just literally are able to be a hermit. Now, I'm not sure how you can do that in this type of society, not doing anything. So those are some questions I think that are concerned out there. I did get an update from John Grant, Executive Director of Celebration Bowl, that says the Cricket MEAC SWAC Challenge kickoff will occur in Atlanta August 28th. We've had no issues to that effect at this point, and no communication or otherwise has been stated. So they're planning to move forward, which is an important note, and then we can put a pin on that at this point. I did want to get into and talk a little bit as we move forward in regards to Dawson Odums. You know, Stephen Gaither broke that, but I want to give you all a chance to have your thoughts on that a little more than what he broke the news, as we had to jump right into the interview with Chris Studdard, the Velvet Teddy Bear. A lot of people seem to enjoy that. But I wanted to get your thoughts, as I'm sure many of our viewers want to know, starting with you, Mike. What are your thoughts in terms of this announcement? Literally huge announcement. We were kind of talking about it a little bit off air, but now you get a chance to share with a lot of people your thoughts on that.
Well, one of the questions I had for Stephen Gaither, I didn't have a chance to answer. He's a lot closer, was how expected or unexpected was this announcement? It's huge, but was this really expected? After 9 years, in my former company, I was traveling back and forth to Baton Rouge, so I stayed a lot closer to Southern University. And over the years, there's been a lot of coaches. He took quite a beating from the Southern alumni at times. And I just wondered if that weighed on him or what, if it reached a head, or if this is something people saw coming. And, at the end of this, he just finally pulled a plug. I wonder how the timing, I guess, is where I'm going at.
Are you saying Jaguar burnout?
I think that's questioning. It could be Jaguar burnout, but I think it's a little simpler than that. I would love to get Carlos' opinion on that. Maybe in here Thursday, but if not, I'm sure he'll discuss it on his show that airs every Saturday from 10 to 12. A little promo to him, shout out to him in terms of that. But to me, I think it was just a simple opportunity. You got to remember that the Norfolk State job recently came open. So without it being open, the urgency for him to leave or the opportunity for him to leave is not there. So I don't think there's a lot much more than that, that the opportunity came open. You also got to look at the fact that they got a one-year extension that was approved at the board because of COVID-19. So I think it's pretty simple. And I don't think people realize that coaches, for the most part, are always trying to stay ahead of the contract.
Yeah.
Right? Trying to stay ahead of the contract year, whether that is with an extension. So if a new athletic director, VP of athletics come in, or new people at the president chancellor's level come in, or new people at the board, that you're always ahead of it. So you at least have a chance to prove yourself. Because a lot of people, as we know in this business, you come in, people tend to want their own people, no matter how good you are, whatever. Yeah. So why I think some of these feelings and culture, I think obviously some of that is in there, but I think it's pretty simple. It was an opportunity that came open. He had a 1 year left on the deal. I'm sure they were going to try to negotiate the deal at Southern. But we've heard from Carlos himself vehemently tell us that the university, Southern University, A&M College, is not giving more than a three-year contract, no more than two-year extension. So at best, he was going to be able to go to 2023 and get a slight raise in terms of what he did this spring. But you have a new 6-year on the table. deal. Where it is a pay raise. What are you going to take?
My part B to that is you're going from the SWAC, whose star has grown, argument, and will grow more in the fall when you bring two schools in, arguably get more coverage, and then you're going to the MEAC. But
that sounds good for us as fans. That doesn't do anything for a coach in terms of his survival. Because if he loses to this more fan base or whatever, they're going to fire him. They're not going to renew the contract. You can't feed your family and have 6 years of $1.3 million on the table talking about, oh, it's going to be exciting in the SWAC about everything going on. That's us for media. That's what we talk about. That a coach could care less. He's going to try to win some games or whatever, but he wants support. This is not even talking about if you listen to Coach Odums also, there's some concerns in terms of if he's getting everything necessary to be as successful as he's been in Southern. Because he sees everybody else raising the bar. And so he's telling his administration, you need to do this. Yep. If they don't have those resources, I don't care how great a coach he is, as everybody else is raised, he understands that they need to raise too. So sometimes, again, it's just about being ahead of the rabbit hole. Just be ahead of the game. It's going to turn on you at some time. And it's not always your fault. It doesn't because you can't coach no better. It's because everybody is chasing the rabbit and you're getting better. You got Alcorn coming over to the East, one of his Achilles heels. In terms of that, not that he don't think he can beat him, but why put yourself in that test if you're not guaranteed? I guarantee you this. If Southern would have said, look, Dawson Odom, we'll match 6 years, 225. I'm sure he'd be like, all right, that makes some sense. I'll probably stay. They wasn't going to match it. They don't do that.
Yep.
So he's going to stay
fair,
with him.
Fair enough.
It's not that hard about all this other magic. Yeah, that's for us. That sounds good. SWAC going to 21, everything to stay nice. You got these. Mm-mm. Coach gonna be like, look, you gonna match the 6 year, you gonna match at least five. Southern's like, peace, thank you. We don't do 5 year deals. The board's not gonna prove it. So why would an AD even waste his time going over there? Speak to somebody, they're gonna be like, we don't do 5 year deals.
Yeah.
Especially the coach that has won championship in a couple of years. Go ahead, Charles.
First and foremost, kudos to Dawson Odums. I've always been a fan. I think, 50 and 12 over his time at Southern. One of the preeminent coaches, not just in the SWAC, but in FCS football. Always has his teams prepared, ready to play. What are they, 8-0, 9-0 versus Jackson State? I'm going to miss him just for that alone. I needed one win. Just always had those teams tremendously well prepared to play. Unfortunately, they didn't get over the Alcorn hump during this time frame, but still one of the more successful programs in HBCU football. The speculation for me now is, who is coming to Southern? You know, who wants to take on this pressure cooker job that is the Southern University head coach? And hear that knock? That's going to be a unicorn come knocking on your door. So, that's going to be interesting because over the last few months, y'all been giggling and memeing me to death and inboxing me to death about Jackson State. They hire who they got. And guess what? Tennessee State folks got a little reality. When a unicorn comes knocking on your door, what do? I'm just saying. Now, I'm saying it's true. It's a lot. A lot of qualified coaches out there. But what happens if a unicorn comes knocking on your door?
I hear the knock. Question is, they go, we go see. That's good. We'll tie it in right there. Let me give a shout out as we get ready to close up the show. I will do the poll, but I want to give a shout out to Alabama State captures SWAC Women's Tennis Championship with a win over Jackson State. Alabama A&M rallies in a thrilling fashion for 4-3 victory over Alabama State to claim first SWAC title. Man, those guys were extremely happy, proud for Alabama A&M. It matches up well with us having Ruben Studdard on the show representing Alabama A&M. MEAC, MEAC Golf announces academic honors. So shout out to those individuals that were honored on that. Shout out to Prairie View, sweeping Southern. That's a pretty
wow. Yeah, didn't see that.
had one on Sunday and followed up with two on Monday, and they got that out there. Shout out there. MEAC baseball, North Carolina A&T took 3 out of 4 to FAMU. FAMU swept early in the season, so they still have the overall record and best record in the Southern Division, so it's going to be interesting to see. That one may tighten up as it goes down the stretch. Look out for North Carolina Central. They're closing out baseball, and they're trying to make a last stand.
Shout out to JSU baseball.
I'm just going to say, JSU baseball continues to get it done. Undefeated. We had a coach on the show last week. Thanks for setting it up, Charles. And he's doing a masterful job. I got to give some shout out to Charles Edmond. I don't know whether it's the Alcorn or Grambling side of him. A little bit of concern now. I don't understand how you're not going to give credit to a team that just beat you to death. First of all, I guess you can question whether they go in the tournament. Can we play the regular season first where they are undefeated and acknowledge the greatness of that?
You need a couple more data points.
I always talk about the Rattler Nation, but kudos to FAMU. They won, their men's golf team won the championship by 19 strokes. So, man, I know Roy is happy back.
That's quite impressive. Last thing I'll leave it on as we get in there is the rankings came out today in terms of, and we can get a little bit on more into this Thursday as we see whether games are going to be played. But the coaches' rankings go in today, which is the fourth tiebreaker, which is going to be interesting, especially with some of these games being canceled. On Monday, the SWAC put out the announcement for the tiebreaker. I'm sure everybody's seen it by now, but let's go over it real quick. SWAC football post-tiebreaker policy is one is head-to-head competition. That's out the window because the teams didn't play head-to-head because we know who are representing for the West, Alabama A&M, off their great victory over Alabama State in the Magic City Classic, and then Arkansas Pine Bluff with that scoring affair, big holding off Prairie View for a big victory, tying up, if you would, the Eastern Division, and now we see that the game against Texas Southern will not be played. So you have the second tiebreaker, which is the overall conference record versus common divisional and non-divisional opponents. 3, record versus non-divisional opponents. 4, the football championship subdivision poll. 5, NCAA-FCS simple rating system, which they did not do this year because COVID-19, so that's out. 6 is the best point differential between tied teams, common head-to-head matchup, which is 6, which will be a reason why you may need Valley to play Alabama A&M because Pine Bluff was already played. That's if you get down to that tiebreaker. 7 is point differential. The teams tied common opponents and then against teams with best overall record, division and non-divisional records. And 8 is coin flip. I don't think we have to worry about getting there. In fact, I think you're going to go to 4 is where you're going to end up stopping, which we got some clarification on today. We have 3 teams ranked in the top 25 coaches poll. Starting at 19 is Southern. They actually got 1 first-place vote. They're 5-1 with 141 points, moving up 2 spots from 21. This, again, is the coaching poll. At 22, which is big, Alabama A&M, 4-0. They were tied to 25th. They moved up 3 spots. And 25 is Arkansas Payne, Pine Bluff, which is 4-0, but not ranked. They can't improve themselves. Be based on not playing this weekend. It's my understanding that this is the last poll because the FCS playoff stopped. So I think this is giving you an indication that if that game with Valley is played, if A&M wins, they will host. If they lose, then it probably goes to Arkansas Pine Bluff. If it's not played, I still think with the ranking at 4 tiebreaker, Alabama A&M will likely host the championship. That's wow. Just my scenario, what I got here. So that's nothing definitive. You have to listen to the SWAC along with Andrew Roberts, who I'm sure will release it and get it to you. We'll have Charles on, but I'm sure it'll come on before we get him on the show to talk a little bit about SWAC championship game in the spring and what is to come in the fall. So look forward for us to do that. So I did want to give that. Before we get in here, let me get into this poll ranking as we will officially close the poll ranking. Some changes in the ranking positions, but nobody falling out. 3rd consecutive week, you have the Golden Lions at 1. I'll go and put that out there. Receiving votes is Alabama State, Delaware State, Jackson State, respectively in terms of the ranking. So Jackson State is just outside of the top 5. one of the reasons I wanted to see this game being played because Prairie View dropped from 4 to 5, and that probably would have determined who was going to be the fifth team in here with Jackson State. Prairie View head-to-head matchup would have been a beautiful way to end the season with that. But Jackson State will end the season at 4-3, 3-2 conference race. Prairie View will end the season at 2-1 overall and in the conference race with 74 points. Number 4, South Carolina State Bulldogs, 3-1. They'll end the season at 3-1 at 81 points, moving up a spot. At number 3, you have Southern Jaguars finishing at 5-1, 4-3. Three first-place votes, 96 points, dropping from number 2 this week, although they had that big win in the Bayou Classic. The impressive win by Alabama A&M in the Magic City Classic over Alabama State pushes them to number 2. 4-0 and 3-0 with 4 first-place votes and 98 points, moving up the spot, as I said. Number 1 continues to be the Arkansas Pine Bluff Golden Lions, 4-0 overall and 4-0 in the conference race, 5 first-place votes, 110 points. Third consecutive week, which sets it up. Obviously, you still have the game to be played. Let me put that in there, depending on what that goes. But it sets it up. Eventually, you'll have a 1-2 matchup for the SWAC Championship game, which is appropriate to see who earns the SWAC Championship, and by de facto, with the win by Alabama A&M over South Carolina State. And so if they win that, obviously, you got to argue that Alabama A&M will probably be the National Black College Championship for the Spring Division. And obviously, if Arkansas beats the team that beat South Carolina State with them in the top 5, Southern Jaguars with the win over Southern Jaguars, another top 5 program, you got to believe that Arkansas Pine Bluff will get it. So just something to think about there in terms of what's going on. Any thoughts on that, Mike?
No thoughts whatsoever. I agree. You would like, you know, that Prairie View game to happen. That would determine who number 5 is. I think the number 1 team is appropriate. Alabama A&M, they all who we thought they were. So that high flying attack. So I hope we do end up with a true number 1 versus number 2. I think, and it's looking like it'll head that way. So no corners for me with the poll.
Good deal. With that, we'll come to a close. We'll tease out Charles and let him get a little thoughts on that on Thursday in terms of what's going on there, what season, and mess with him a little bit, unless he wants to jump in there and get his thoughts on the poll ranking. But that'll do it for us. Thank you for listening to Inside. Did you want to get some thoughts on the final poll ranking, Charles?
No, I agree with you wholeheartedly. I think right now UAPB is the team that has showed the most promise here in the spring. And however, you know, the tiebreaker system works out, it'll be a great SWAC championship.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. Great point there. And we know one person that will be on there making sure the TV, his big flat screen TV is focused. It looks like it'd be a Huntsville, Alabama. I guess Tyler Carr, as he said last week, he'll be excited Stephen Gaither to have a short drive.
That's right.
We'll get good coverage. Thank you for listening to Inside the HBCU Sports Lab. Make sure you share our podcast with your friends and colleagues. Thank you for dealing with us with our technical difficulties, but we were able to bring you a full show, and I hope you enjoyed our guest, none other than Steve Gaither, breaking the news in terms of Southern's Dawson Odom leaving that football program and heading to the MEAC with Norfolk State to see if he can get it done there. Fascinating news there. Some people are reporting a 6-year contract at 225. We'll see if we can verify that in terms of what that looks like. Also, a great interview with Alabama A&M alumni, Ruben Studdard, better known as Chris to us. We hope you enjoyed the interview with him and Stephen Gaither breaking that news. Again, we want to thank you for listening to Dr. Cavil's Inside HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington, Charles Bishop, every Tuesday and Thursday right here at 6:00 Central Standard Time. We look forward to the next week as we will discuss the latest news in the lab. Follow me, Dr. Kenyatta Cavil, DrKen. YattaCavil, that's DrKenyattaCavil on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. That's Inside the HBCU Sports Lab, Facebook, Inside the HBCU Sports Lab, YouTube. With that, make sure you check out the 1400 Club with Charles Bishop and Neely. Make sure you check out Mike Washington, Allen, and Joe Clay, and the others in terms of 1876 Sports and Culture Podcast. Dream big and continue to move forward. We will talk with you soon. Charles.
Course.
Mike.
Lecture.
Yes,
To the HBCU Sports Lab to see if my team won or lost. If they lost, I'm quiet as a mouse. But if they won, keep tab. I'm a